Of the Alhambra, you know what the Alhambra looks like, the beautiful citadel that was built by the Moors in Granada in Spain. And Granada was the last city that was held by the Moors. It was held by, that means it was held by an Islamic regime, and, but not, you know, a little bit different from some of the Islamic regimes we know today. It was in part of its history, a very enlightened culture, certainly preferable to the brutality of the Spanish kings who came after it. But there was, you know, 7 centuries of war in Spain, constant war between the Christians and the Muslims. And finally, the Spanish encircled the last city that the Moors held, which was Granada. And Boabdil, who was the Moorish king, went out to fight on the plains of Granada and was defeated by the Spaniards and had to surrender the city. And there's some all kinds of lore, and you know, has grown up around this final battle, and it's what they said, you know, even the Siglo de Oro composers, these people like Milan Mudarra, Narváez, Fuegnana, this golden century was called, when the Spanish were at the peak of their power, the Siglo de Oro, the century of gold, Siglo, century, de oro, of gold, Siglo de Oro. There were also a whole bunch of great composers who wrote for the vihuela. The vihuela was sort of like a 10-string guitar, as you probably know. 12-string guitar, and double strings, 6 double strings. And it sounded a lot like the lute, but it didn't look like the lute because the Spanish kings had banished everything Islamic, and the lute was associated with the Moors, so they got rid of it. There's no Spanish lute music, there's vihuela music. With a very similar style, but it's not lute, because lute was associated with the Muslims, so it can't have that, they're out, you know. So, but as they say, what you drive out, the door comes back in through the window. And they couldn't ever eliminate the Spanish, the Moors, the Spanish could never eliminate the Moorish influence, the Islamic influence. It got stuck in the language. So there are sounds in the Spanish language that you have in no other, practically, well, you have a bit of it in Greek, actually, and in maybe in Dutch, but very markedly in Spanish, you have this, the sound of the H, Jota, right? Jota. So many, many words have that sound, which doesn't resemble other European languages so much. And you have also all these words that start with AL, like alfombra, aljibe, alhambra, almacén. Alfombra is a carpet, aljibe is a well, almacén is like a bazaar or something. And of course, alhambra, which comes from alhambra, which is in Arabic means the red has a kind of a reddish stone. So the Spanish couldn't get rid of that. And on the guitars, they started to do all these ornaments, like here on the rosette. It doesn't resemble anything in Western art. It's an Islamic thing. You know? And they even had in the flamenco the danza mora, the Moorish dance. So we have a lot of pieces like Capricho Árabe of Tartaga, right? Which is a very melancholy piece for the most part. Right? And we always have this major minor thing. D major, D minor in this. Even he goes to F major, but then he uses the flat 6 of F. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So he has a little, you know, little mixture of the minor always with the MIDI. So you have this, now the original arpeggio is not, play this one, what's it? So I play this, but it's more of a pain in the neck to play, because you're crossing the thumb under the finger. Sando. Let me hear the opening. Yeah. Maybe instead of having the fingers so in the string, it's more the rasqueado. We teach the rasqueado in classical guitar maybe not the correct way. Because we teach it like classical way. It's almost you come across the top of the string more. It's more of a bite to it. it's all right. Bringing the wrong note out. The note that he wants. So maybe you. I prefer to this. This brings out the wrong. This wrong note. So, that's not as interesting. So, you, in your case, you just do PIM. It also sounds beautiful. PIM is forwards. Such a repressed society in Spain. There was a language, a fan language, that the young people could talk to each other as well. Women would talk to the men. They like you, it's one way. If they don't like you, it's another way, kind of thing. And so it kind of has that. So this is the copia rasgada. You see how light this is? It's not beating on the guitar so much. Rasgado means scratching. Rasgado. It's not like tearing at the strings so much. Beautiful. Beautiful. Gorgeous. Spanish pieces that all kind of do that, right? Yeah. So that's what you're imitating. And then the magic, then the Moorish ghosts come out. For now it's just, we're walking by the nice Torre del Meca. It's set down a little bit on the hill. Maybe someday we'll come to Granada and we'll go there together. But It's often this little, you see it on the way, walking up to the Alhambra, Torre Bermeja. It means that, I don't know what the Bermeja part means, but the Torre is a gate. It's one of the gates in the town. So, let's see. One. Where's your bed today? You can get it down here, but here. C sharp, G. So I could also do this. There it is. Or here. Here's another one, C sharp, A and G. There's one there, there's one here. There's one here. All over the place. You know, when we do Spanish music on the guitar, they would love to have these colors on the piano. We don't have the range, we don't have the power, but we have the charm. And so the great transcribers always use these little tricks. Jobet used in Segovia, Tarrio was a genius for it. And they would compensate sometimes for lack of quantity of notes with something unusual. Like we do in Leandro, you know. Make many changes in the middle. Okay, so we have this. Now here we go. I'll show it to you later. Don't worry about it. So, been a nation of extremes, you know. And when you see, when you go to the bullfight, it's an insanity, it's a national insanity. And you see this beautiful bull come, they let the bull into the ring and it's dancing around everywhere, toro, 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 you know. You think, oh, this is fun. And then the first guy comes out, the big fat guy on a horse, which is, the horse has all this protection, so the bull can't possibly do anything to the horse. And this guy comes out, this immense, probably 12 feet long, it has a spike at the end, and he sticks it into the bull, he pulls it out, and all of a sudden there's this red gash on the bull. And he gets done. And then the little quick guys come out with their banderillas, and they stick them in, you know, in this side and this side with all their flowery stuff. You know. And then finally, the matador, which means the killer, the torero, the guy that's gonna, you know, the pasos, he comes out, right? And then he does his paso here and his paso here, you know, toro, toro, all this kind of stuff, you know. And then finally, of course, goes in for the kill. And you should, I mean, the gestures, I know that I have Spanish friends, they love it. They think it's just great, you know. I found it nauseating, you know, completely nauseating. But, you know, Spain is, it's like part of the religion. We know religion can make people do insane things. So. Make people do wonderful things, but many times crazy things. So that's all inside of this whole, you know, psychodrama, this inside this stuff. Less tragic, but there's thank you. loves this chord. Side of the nails. Side to get this.
Yeah.
You can fix that in a second, but that's you'll get it immediately. Beautiful. Terrific. Is rather extreme. This kind of Segovian vibrato, we have the fourth finger way on the side. Here you move to get the sound, but more on the... Ah, gorgeous, fantastic. Fantastic. It's the chord for forte, I believe. There's no sign that the forte is not there. I don't think it's the diminuendo yet.
So I just stay on the first string and then play.
bit of an argument with Pepe on which F that was. In here, it says F sharp. And
that's natural.
Really?
Okay.
That's two significant votes for
F. No. He said natural, right? I agree with him.
Yeah.
Because otherwise you don't have the change. The reason that it needs to be natural is because it makes the what comes after it more contrasting.
Okay.
That is the reason for it. So if you give away the F sharp, you give away the aha moment.
Okay.
So I agree with Pepe. No one. Here's more bitter because it. I do a fake pizzicato here because it. I'd like better. If you do.
What exactly?
There are three possibilities you could do. The way I was taught by my teacher when I was taught, he said, you keep this finger down.
Right.
So one way is you could keep the finger up so it's not quite as stifled as long. Or I do even sometimes. I don't like really stifled pits. So whatever you do, you can like, if you just start, stop the beginning of the sound and then get off of it. Yeah. Otherwise it sounds too stifled for my taste. But you know, you can do this. See, I kind of bounce, so I do. So I cut the beginning of the sound, but then I let, so I have more resonance, so I do. So just cut, here, listen, so it goes like this. So I kind of cut it, but then
you're really rotating the hand.
Yeah, a lot, yeah.
Is that how you're getting, F so clearly?
I can't even tell you, I mean, we could look at the camera, we could analyze it. But I just do it by ear, really. It's so much quicker than describing it. It's like when you get something new and you have to read the damn owner's manual. I mean, it's just awful. It's like the worst thing could happen. So, you're so talented and you're so musical. You're so gifted. You just play it by ear, it'll be perfect. And anything you like will be perfect because you're just so talented. You know? So, yes, you could read the owner's manual, but I don't think you need to. You know, you've got it already. I'm just explaining a little bit more technically
how I might do it. You know, like I like a little.
I saw how these guys play really close, you know, really close up. Same with Bill Frisell, who's going to be with us, you know, later, a few hours from now. You know, and I said, this is, you know, there's no notation that could capture it. So the guitar, it will resist notation till its dying day. The guitar will never succumb to notation, especially in Spanish music. So. You know, we don't even really know how to notate the rasgueado because you look at the start of the Aranjuez concerto, you know. What did Rodrigo say? He said, this should sound like the butterflies in the gardens of the Generalife, or the Aranjuez, he said the Aranjuez, right? Aranjuez is where the Spanish kings would go in the summer. It's beautiful, you know, it's really hot, everybody's sweating in Madrid. They go to Aranjuez a little bit far from Madrid, and they have a wonderful time. So. Thank you. it's not. You know, it's so ugly. It's first of all, it's good. You never try to get all corners back. I have a little special finger. I go down, down, up. And I have never had a string in 40 years of teaching studies except my fingering. But it's a very good fingering. Look, watch. I watched how the players actually play Rascalo, and they say this, all the flamenco players will say, you never try to play all the notes of the chord all the time. It sounds like bad tourist Rascalo. So, Spanish music, you must be very careful with the notation, because it's only a suggestion. Basically, it's a message in a bottle. Musical score is a message in a bottle to you. It was sent by the composer. The composer doesn't know who's going to pick up the bottle, and who's going to open it, who's going to read the message, and if the person who reads the message even speaks his language, you know. The composer has sent this bottle out into the universe, hoping for a sensitive heart somewhere. There's somebody that will not just take the letter of the law, but get the spirit of the law, will use his imagination. You know, and this, somehow people have got talked out of doing this. And Segovia had a beautiful metaphor for this. You know the metaphor of Lazarus, who was raised from the dead by Christ. When Christ goes and sees Lazarus is dead, Christ says, arise and go forth. You know, stay out from the and levántate y anda. Right? This is what he is in Spanish, right? Stand up and go forth. So Lazarus was dead in the tomb. Christ said, boom, and Lazarus stands up out of the tomb. So Segovia said, the notes on the page are like Lazarus dead in the tomb, and the performer, the interpreter comes and says, arise and go forth. Levántate y anda. If you don't do that, it's just dots on the page. And somebody with you know, your sensibility and talent has, you know, so much to give in this way. But try to make it an informed kind of giving. So, you know, if you don't speak Spanish, learn Spanish. Get inside the culture. And really, the part of Spain that guitar music is greatest in Andalusia is really North Africa. You know? And it's not just, you know, a nice, civilized. There's lots of blood and murder and everything. You know, it's a graveyard. You know, it's like what gave us the blues in this country. You know? It's incredible suffering. No end in sight. And the flamenco is the Gitanos version of the Roma de Zinti, whoever it is that are there. You know, it used to be called gypsies. I think now we use other words from the Roma, Zinti, I don't know. Maybe there are other groups too. It's their music. You know. And this got into everything. It got into Boccherini. It got into Scarlatti. Right? It got into Spanish music at all times. And of course, it's very deep in Almeida's piano music. Anyway, terrific. How am I doing for time? I have no concept.
15 more minutes.
Thank you. All right. So, let us just talk about how you get back when you have a... this one, and you add both. had the D under it. But it's easier with the bar, isn't it? Yeah. It's not so much loud. You're in the strings too much. You have to. Look, you're coming like this, like 90 degrees. You have to come almost like this. And you can experiment. When the flamenco singers sing, they have a little scratch. It almost sounds like they've got a cigarette cough when they sing.
Yeah,
a lot of that, you know. And then you find someone like Morente, who's so lyrical as a flamenco singer, and still has the, you know, from her father, who I knew very well, who was a neighbor of mine, Enrique Morente. But you know, Spain is really a deep well.
Well, we're gonna go check it out this summer.
Yeah, you are fantastic. That's wonderful. Well, you'll see firsthand. Really, it's not all the famous places that really. I always find in any of these, you know, these places that we all. It's not even. You know, I don't even like so much being inside the Alhambra. I like looking at the Alhambra from far away, or I go up in the morning at 7 a.m. and walk around outside, not even going through all the Patio de los Leones and all this kind of stuff. I don't even, but it's something, when you walk in the Alhambra scene, you just walk in it, you have to smell the flowers, you know, and walk the streets, and just, it enters into your soul. And then late at night when they turn off the lights on the Alhambra, and the Alhambra is stretched out there on the mountaintop, like a beautiful mood body. It's more impressive under the moonlight than with all the lights. And it's just there. You see the Torre de la Vela. There's a big torre called the Tower of the Candle. And you hear the wind snapping the flags up there. It comes across the valley to you. And that's the Alhambra is something. The Germans have a word for it. Unheimlich. It's just an indescribable. And that will enter into your young soul and make music out of it. And that's your job, really. Because you have so much talent for everything. Listen inside. What does it mean to you? I'm really not so interested in what it means to me. I'm interested in what does it mean to you? And how will you fuse those experiences with your beautiful guitar playing? Okay, something about that. Bravo. Thank you. play that cold in a cold, overly air-conditioned room so well. So this is a very interesting piece in so many ways. It's one of his great pieces. He knew it was great. That's why he made three versions of it. This one, of course, the one for violin was first, and this one. And of course, the version that he orchestrated and put into the key of D major in the Cantata 29. So if we want to have an idea, you know, what kind of emotions was he thinking about when he wrote his music? I always think that a very, you know, people say, oh, read Kranz, who is a great, you know, great flute player who wrote a great treatise about 1752. Read Bach's son, Philipp Emanuel Bach. Philipp Emanuel, who wrote another great keyboard treatise also around the turn of the century, about the time Bach died, right after Bach died, published it. You know, Versuch über die Bauart, Klavier zu spielen. You know, these are all wonderful sources, but really the best source of Bach is Bach himself. You know, ask Bach, he'll probably tell you a good answer. And so, if we want to get a feeling, what was this, what's the ambiance of this piece, or where's this, you know, coming from? Well, the text in the cantata is, Wir danken dir, O Gott, which means, we thank you, O God. And it's a very joyful cantata, and it was performed in Leipzig, as, you know, it was a big festive event that was being, inaugurating some new person. I forget, there was some kind of Staatsfeier, some city celebration of some sort, and this cantata was premiered there. And, of course, as you know, it has trumpets, it has timpani, and the organ gets the violin part in the right hand, and then there's a moving bass line and everything. It's just, the opening of that cantata is just some of the most, it's just 10 minutes about of, you know, of even less, 8 minutes of perfection. It is just beyond perfection. It's just like if only life could be like that. You know, this wonderful prelude or sinfonia, followed by the gratias agium, what became the gratias agium of the Mass, which also means in Latin, we thank you, O God, which is this incredible fugue that he wrote, which he used again in the B minor Mass as the gratias agium and also as the Dona Nobis Patrum at the end of the Mass. So he used, you know, three versions of that fugue also, three versions of this prelude. He knew it hit gold with this one, you know, and he used it a lot. So that's first thing, you know, he loved the piece, we love the piece, everybody loves the piece, it's just got everything. You know, you can play this piece, you know, in a gymnasium full of 400 squirming school children, and they almost will stop talking to each other and listen. So I know from personal experience. So. Violin version. I mean, forget this version. Think about the violin version. The first measure has six notes, and there you have 4 + 4 = 8 notes. So 8 and 6 = 14. So the number of notes, that's his name also. Right? That's the Bach name, because 2 + 1 = 3 + 3 = 6 + 8 = 14. If you have, like, you know that trick that Bach was very involved with the letters of the alphabet in their order. Acquire also a numerical value. So A is 1, B is 2, C is 3, etc. So Bach's name, B-A-C-H, adds up to 14. And he would, you know, he used that a lot in many, many ways. So it so happens that he starts with 6 plus 8, 14 notes. I mean, so that's kind of interesting. The other thing that he has is his number one, his thematic signature is this. He uses it everywhere. He uses it everywhere. Brandenburg Concerto, the fugue subject, it's everywhere. Da da da. It's 2 + 1 kind of thing. You know, it's got everything. You know, it's a symmetrical structure. Right, so, and then you have right. uses it every place. So this also has its inversion. So when you have, and then it's linked, right? So you have the inversion and the original version. And so we have also, and then a third that comes down. Something else. two notes, like Bach, one note, down a third, and ends in ha. So it's also kind of a singular, because you have two, two, and one is A, and then a third, and then you have ha. The note B natural, called in German ha. So that's your A. This is two, one, the third down, and here it is again. So it's a signature within a signature. That doesn't help you play it, anybody. You're interested in how do you play it then. But that's a very interesting thing, because if you want to understand the piece, here he fills out the third. And here, that's the inversion in augmentation. So the inversion of the theme is, or that's the theme goes. That's the inversion, but that's the inversion slowed down, right? The filling in the theme, and here's this is the inversion, but slowed down, right? So it's always the piece is packed with that. Then we have. So the inversion of the third is the sixth. And the version of the second is the seventh. So seven, six, seven, six, seven, six, seven, six to an octave. That's what's happening harmonically. So I mean, and look how he writes it. That's his rhythmic. That's how he writes, right, in the open string. Dum-bidi-dum-bidi-dum-bidi-dum-bidi-dum. That's this. That's the rhythmic part, fused with the third idea. So the whole piece is just made out of this DNA. And that can make you know things even simpler, even the end. And then you have the theme, canon. It has it in two voices. Dum, ba, ba, bum, ba, ba, bum, is everywhere. Right? Again and again and again. And even the harmonic regions in the piece. Do this. So it goes out. So the first main, and then the next E is C major, C sharp minor, right? And then the next one is A. So the keys go E major, C sharp minor, A major, and then. Keys go down in thirds, and then big stop on the dominant seventh. Okay, so those are some general things to think about, and it can help you, you know, because there's so many notes to play. But you will find again, you know. Sorry. So yeah, here's the. This is the inversion, and this is the main version of it. But slow down. I said. You see, they're interlocked, but at a slower tempo. Right, so all these themes are done at different tempos, different speeds throughout the whole piece. And that's what holds it together. This musical DNA has been composed out by Bach. And the whole magic is, of course, how does he do it? You know, that's where the genius is. That's where the genius is. Anybody can come along and find these little things. Oh, this, yeah, but you do it. You know. It's just, oh, Vivaldi wrote the same piece 400 times. Okay, Stravinsky, you go write that just once, you know. And it's not that easy to do. Even these composers that you, like Scarlatti, Vivaldi, you know, they wrote hundreds of pieces in a recognizable form. But if you actually try to write even a Scarlatti sonata, or write a Vivaldi concerto movement, you will see how difficult it was, and it is. And Bach, remember, you know, Vivaldi's, I think, very underrated in a way. Overrated and underrated. Overrated because everybody knows just knows the seasons, you know, and underrated because he was such a great composer. Bach said he learned style and he learned form from Vivaldi. So Bach learned from Vivaldi, you know, that's, you know, saying something. And this piece, of course, is very Italianate. You know, very. It's not like a French, you know, very severe French thing with a, you know, an overture and a fugue movement and a da capo of the overture. It's just a florid burst of Italian joy, followed by this totally French, delicate movement, totally intimate. You're after this big celebration. Bach goes off in some little chapel and prays to God all by himself off in a corner. You know, it's very interesting, this partita, as far as the different postures that the different movements have. All right, let's take it from the top. It's also in 3-4, that's another, right? So the Trinity thing is getting its work out. So that's another aspect of 3. it's much more exciting like that. It's terrific. But of course, you're warmed up. I mean, just to sit down and play this piece cold is a bit terrifying. I understand. All right, the other thing I'd like to talk about is the dynamics of... This part is...
Thank you.
very brilliant. And then, since you have it ready.
Yeah.
And let's have a little look at it.
Okay.
Of rondos, you know, mm-hmm. And they will always have something very delicious, and they keep coming back to it. So it's like, you know, you start off in a great place, and then you go off and have like a little visit. So you have a little visit to your first little visit, you go off into C sharp minor, right? So we just had this little excursion. We have to. Contrast between where we end up here and there. So we have it. And the gavotte is always a 3-4 pickup. 3-4-1, so la da da. Of this piece. So you see, the gavotte was rod, rod. It's very simple. Rod. What is it? Roddy bum, roddy bum. Everybody does this, right? It is. Oh, you can't dance, you're already dead in the water. You see, no. That's the paradox. No. Roddy. Recognize the rhythm? Ba-da-bum. Just slow down. Mm-hmm. Augmentation is called something. That's this. It's like talking da 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 da. What do you think? Da 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 capriccio sopra la lontananza del fratello dilettissimo, the capriccio on the departure of the beloved brother. Because we know the brother has to leave, has to go on a trip. So now we know this. Oh, of course he has to go on a trip. That's this. You know, of course you have to go on this trip. Be careful. You know? Sounds exactly the same, but it has to be sadder. Yodipodidum. That's a modulation.
So it's not dance. Or
excuse me?
It is still in the dance. Or
it is
or
the
is
dance,
it
but it's a little bit sad. It's a completely different place. Let's walk around. Let's walk around in the room of C sharp minor. C sharp minor. Coming back home, but it always seems different because we were just somewhere else. Oh, I was just. But this is so delicious. I love coming home. Where are we going now? Mein Sinn in the Johannes Passion, I think it's a very Ach mein Sinn, wo willst du endlich hin? It's a very jagged, dotted movement in the Johannes Passion. I think it's in F sharp minor. Thank you. feminine ending. People do the feminine ending like that. That's a different piece. But this is so happy, you know. When this is a very misunderstood piece. You know, it's all about excursions and then coming back. If you want to listen to great rondos, of course, the Couperin was a great master. Les barricades mystérieuses, you know that one. It's not in this key. That one. And the TikTok shock also is a. It's a clock. Tick 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 tock 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 tick tock. It's a one for you. That's all the time. And then it goes away to somewhere else, and then comes back to the rondo.
You have it here, you know.
Yeah. He goes back and forth, goes somewhere else, comes back to that. That's the other one that we have in the guitar repertoire. It's the other one that's like. Okay, beautiful play. Is this the last person we have? Or do I have one more?
No, we have another one, Anson.
Thank you. No, this is the markings from my teacher. This
like, what did he found some quote of Albinus that says something like this?
I guess so.
I can't quite read what the first word is.
I think it says romantic to the point of paroxysm. Yeah.
Of paroxysm. Romantic to the point of paroxysm and sad to the point of despair, Albinus. I don't know if he's talking about this piece or something in general about Albinus.
I would guess that it's in general.
Yeah. Okay. So this is a portrait of the city of Granada.
Yeah.
And the city of Granada is, of course, in Andalusia, in the south of Spain. And it's part of that trifecta, Córdoba, Sevilla, Granada, you know, the three, Malaga, I guess. But really, it's Sevilla, which is the capital of Andalusia. And the people of Sevilla, you know, they think that New York is a distant suburb of Sevilla or something.
Yeah.
It's almost amazing. They're a little bit similar to the people from Napoli in Italy. You know, Napoli is in Naples, we say. It's this city just has a bunch of characters. But Granada is a very special city. It's, first of all, it's higher up than Sevilla and Cordoba. It's a little, that means in the summer when it still gets to be 100 degrees or 110 or whatever it gets. But the cold wind comes off cooler wind comes off the Sierra, off the mountains and blows towards Granada. So you might even be cold at 2 or 3 in the morning if you go out in Granada. And there's always water. And it flows down the hill from the Alhambra. You hear always the water. Always water. Mm-hmm. Water means life, you know, in a desert environment. That's a definite desert environment. So this, in the original piano chords, are four. So, of course, all that survives the guitar transcripts are two notes. But the piano even has the arpeggiation ring, so. Roll those thirds. And here we don't even have it in just one note. So that's the idea. So you have this melody that's kind of against the beat, you know. If you just hear it, you wouldn't know how to even bar it, because Albinus does this a lot. He writes in two and he writes in three at the same time. So it's one, but if you just hear, you could beat in two. One and two and a three and you could do it like this. So it's written in a hemiola.
Right.
All the way through. And that's what keeps it floating, that's what keeps it natural. And these third. Thank you. just happens after you have the G major. The G major is far away. That's a real romantic era harmonic shift. Schubert does that kind of thing a lot. Where you have this the tone that's common to E major. That's a really change, and then it goes back to B major. So this, is keeps changing color. It's like when you're outside and some cloud comes across the sun, all of a sudden it goes dark and then it comes light again. This kind of thing, this changing of color. So this E is always going to get softer, so try and disappear so it stays in your future. You kill your own melody. You go down, and then once the melody's really gone, then you bring the accompaniment back up. So you have to accompany your own long notes. Dies on the vine.
Yeah.
That's gorgeous. Fantastic. Beautiful, vibrato. Beautiful. Once again. Accompany your own long note, remember? Even more, you can come under, because once you play them, disappear with your accompaniment. You see, once you do. You hear the harmonic come out of the guitar about three beats in? Did you hear that? You have to listen for that. You hear it just came back? But if you do, you kill it.
Yeah.
Okay. This is very subtle. Not many people know to do this. But you're doing it beautifully. Once again. But there's some recordings of Enrique Granados playing in.
Yeah,
it's very, 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 very free in a way that nobody would dare to do it now. So I think that's a good sign. Thank you.
another third. It's almost like Liszt uses that kind of thing. That's the tune. It's very Arabic.
Yeah.
So very magical. It's the difference between sadness and happiness. So this was pretty happy. You may not have that augmented second in there, so Gobi didn't play it, but I think it's correct.
It's not in this version.
Yeah, I think it's correct.
It could be.
Anyway, play it's all right. It's also all right without it. Try to connect. Instead of bum, 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 beat, make a longer line. Don't go measure and measure and one, two, three, one, two. It's measure six and seven and eight. It's a long line. It's not D, bum, bum, beam. No, it's a. By the notation, it's guitar music, you know. Mm-hmm. We always arpeggiate a little bit. The thing is not to arpeggiate in a predictable way.
Good.
myself.
Now we have a flat six. Mm-hmm. That always leads you right to the. Sacromonte, you know? It's the other part of Granada. Back in the caves in Sacromonte, they're doing that. You know? It's actually all a C pedal.
Original.
Yeah.
Es imposible callarla. El llanto de la guitarra es imposible callarla. The lament of the guitar, it is impossible to quiet it. Es imposible callarla. Norte. But it's an echo.
Listen to your own long note. Listen. If I do, I give the illusion that the note lasts.
I believe. I don't think this one has them.
Yeah, maybe.
part of the Eliot Flamenco. Okay, how am I doing for time? So I'm throwing a lot of stuff at you, you know, and I don't expect you to. It's impossible to, you know, absorb it all in a few minutes. But you show that you completely understand it by your reactions. So you know you can go back to the original and look at all the different versions that have been published. Segovia has a beautiful version. Tarek has a very interesting version. I mean, he is the one that has. I just thought that was so cool. And then I start. Yeah. Aware of what the harmonic underpinnings are. It's always the same thing, just in original, it's four octaves he does it. But on the guitar, we have to repeat. That's why I tried to play a different way. So, one time. So, I did it. First, then. To have different colors. So, I don't. Yeah.
Sure that I can play that connection right there.
Very good. Here. I do two quizzes for them. Also this one. Shared concerts together. And this is the famous place where Albanian says to Tarka, that's what I was trying to do when I wrote for the piano. So, you know, this very, very free version. Mm-hmm. That's what the composer says. Oh, that's what I was trying to do when I wrote it in F major.
Yeah.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
know, some people would later. Also has something for you, they tune maybe some, maybe even tune the string down, but then you're in trouble here. You know, so we end up with, I think it's a good key. See? Where's that? It's a sixth string sound here. This is one of the most important things about playing the guitar, is being aware of the acoustic classical guitar, are the harmonics that come out of the instrument naturally. Especially in this piece, pieces like this, where we don't have the notes, we don't have the register, we don't have the, you know, we don't have this all the time. We don't have that. We don't have four notes to play and then fit it out of room. So four notes become two. Right, because I told you the piano is that in the right hand. It's all,
yeah.
You know, it's, but that's the water of Granada. That's the liquid. So we have to. You've got to arpeggiate that.
Okay.
Very important. And when you get it, yeah, don't go. You did something. I wouldn't do this sounds. If you do it, you can do that. Something so simple, but it's definitely it's not a 6-4 chord. You know, it's a G in the bass. You didn't play it. You played it. That's correct. Some people like this is really bad. The 6-4 chord is really bad. You don't want a D in the bass. You want a G chord.
Yeah.
Now it's about to. There's always a C pedal. So the F in minor is above the C pedal. You can use the flesh to get a nice sustain of the bass. Back and forth.
Awesome.
I have a lot of music. Is this your music?
Yeah, it's mine. I can grab it in a second.
Okay, do you mind one more person? So what are we going to do?
I would like to work on Anagia.
Anagia by Turin. Or Torropa, Mario Torropa.
Yes.
This one.
That one is. A little
slower. Okay, fine. Actually a popular song. Ahí tienes mi corazón. You have got my heart. You've stolen my heart. So that's the idea of it. Very appassionato. Or appassionato. Appoyando is pushing the string down. Before you play the string, you have to make sure that you've got the fingertip and the fingernail in the right constellation so you don't get the sound that ka-chuck, ka-chuck, ka-chuck. No, you have to, for this, you have to squeeze the fingertip into the nail so you don't get this ka-chunk, ka-chunk. That's good. And basically, instead of pulling the string back and parallel to the soundboard, try to drive the string vertically down in. Exactly. You see, you're very talented. Very talented.
Push I was just told before to push the string down, but I didn't get it. This was a couple years ago, but I feel like I'm getting it.
You certainly got it beautifully. That's excellent. The only thing you must make sure you come in the right part of the finger so you don't get ka-chunk, ka-chunk, ka-chunk with the nail, you know, making noise. So if you have to kind of squeeze the finger into the nail. So what we want is the clarity of the nail and the depth of this flesh sound. Adding with the left hand, the vibrato, It's like the seasonings and the, you know, we don't just cook the food, we usually stick some kind of seasonings. Well, the left hand is the seasoning. If you don't want seasonings, you play the harp or the piano and have no vibrato. Right? So this is the whole heart and soul of the guitar in a way. You know, this is the engine, but this is a... And people say, you know, how do you do the vibrato? And I can explain it physically, and it never really works. I mean, if I explain it physically, you know, I usually tell them, well, you don't want to pay such a high price. Because the vibrato is like, you know, sort of like the blues. It comes from the suffering of people. And suffering is a very interesting idea, because none of us choose to suffer. No, we would much rather not have to suffer. We not have to feel things so deeply, not be hurt by them. Some of us can't help ourselves, and so we feel things very deeply, and then there's no place for the feelings to go except the music, and so it comes out in the music. So I can tell you one thing about the vibrato. A lot of people, they move the arm, they move the elbow, they move the shoulder, all this stuff. Yes, in guitar vibrato, in my opinion, it's all this last little joint here in the finger. It's all, and you know, fooling around with that. When people do this elbow vibrato, I find it vulgar. I find it very ugly. I think electric guitars are really different. They have to get, you know, it's a totally different instrument. But the classical guitar, for example, if I'm out here, I can't. I'm here like that, and I'm very near to the guitar, so I have a lot of stability in the hand.
So.
This way is every possible. You move till you like it. Now the other thing that you're not doing yourself any favor with the right hand is you're over here, you know. Maybe your string tension on that guitar is so low that you need to go a little bit more here. The other thing is you're back here.
Sure.
So I'm holding here with the thumb. Then also, remember to aim. I think you're kind of, you're a little bit too far back on the finger. I think you may need the finger slightly more, this slightly more vertical. You're kind of doing it. So you got this, getting this sound because you're leaning back this way. But you have got to get the finger. That's more like that. Go straight down. Watch out there. Okay, the M finger's not doing it right, the I finger's doing it perfectly. Can you turn, instead of coming straight back, turn slightly, either this way or this way. That's not good, then the rest of the sound will sound scratchy. Right? Very good. It's a lot better than it was about 5 minutes ago. That's terrific. Now when you do this,
might put a finger on the top string because of sometimes we get this, so just stop that. So I might do this with the A finger on the top string. At least. So when I do this, you don't seem to be having that problem. I have it. Scale separate, I mean, and distinct and beautifully, but in a different way. So the music is asking us to feel things. The music is asking us to react. Kind of one gesture that holds together rather than two different gestures. Very good, very good. So, now we have the tune. Now the tune is in the bass. Let's hear from this.
like louder. Off this right side of the nail. Instead of coming straight down the middle, turn off to the side. No, the other side. That way. Yeah. So. Try not to come down straight, but off to the side. It's always the M finger that's doing that scratch. And the I finger's doing it perfectly. So let the I finger teach the M finger what to do. Probably it may need a little bit more nail on the M finger.
Yeah.
Just a little bit more.
More nail on the M finger?
Probably, because it sounds like it's not quite, you know, not quite long enough. It doesn't need much. Tiny bit, a day or two of growth would probably be perfect.
Yeah.
Something like that. All right, very good. Yeah, good. I don't have a lot more to say. We've been over the important ideas. How long have you been playing classical guitar?
I haven't played classical guitar for
3-4 years, 5 years.
Probably like nine.
9 years. How old are you now?
I am 15.
15?
Yes.
Oh, you're very young. A lot of room to grow. All right. Well, this is a good piece to start with. It's a good, but it's not easy, you know. This stuff is very. Why is it difficult? This is the hard thing. So when you're practicing it, you go. You have to get that. Because really, the hard part is that hammer on, right? So don't play the note before the hammered on note too loud, because the hammered on note won't be able to compete. In other words, you would think you hit the G hard and then the A will be louder, but actually it's better if you don't hit the G too hard, because the A can never compete. This hammered on A is never going to be as good a note as this. So give yourself a chance and don't hit it. So that way, see, that sounds much more even than a G. If I do that, I hardly hear the A. If I hit it. Maybe you should play an E. Sounds a little richer. You can also take a little bit of liberty.
us. A very good beginning. Do you have these Segovia scales?
I do have the Segovia scales.
Do you practice those?
One at a time, yes.
Yeah, one at a time. Okay. The thing about when you practice technique is, don't let your mind fall asleep. Okay, now I don't have to. Now I don't have to be creative. I don't have to think about anything. I just follow. No, you could do all kinds of different rhythms for the scales. For example, the two rhythms that get every fast motion there is are. Find the right spot where you don't scratch like that. Probably it's further up towards the nail, not so far back. When you're back here is when you start back here. That's when you, but you, if you, the further you get up towards the nail, the easier it is to pinch the splash into the nail and avoid that scratchy sound that we don't want. No, you've got to find a better place. Closer to the nail. Closer to the nail. I would go to the other side of the, you gotta look for. Squeeze it in. See, that's a nice sound. But you're doing this. So if you come up, so you drive the string down.
Yeah.
There's maybe a sound over here as well.
Yeah.
But not so far back, because that's what's making the scratch. You've gotta aim up here. If you get the right place, you'll be all right.
I mean, I just did it, so I know it's
that. That was good, that's good. You notice that when you're back here, it's worse. Play the third string. No, you don't want to do this. You want to have this up here so you can drive the string down into the guitar. That's it. Don't sit back here and reach forward. Don't do that. You want to be up here. This knuckle about over the third or second string. This one.
Kind of anywhere I go or above the string that I'm playing?
Well, there are two theories about this. Pepe, Romero, the great virtuoso, he plays more back like this and has one position. But Angel does what I do. We follow the string. So it depends, you know, who's going to quarrel with Pepe Romero how he plays, you know. But so, I mean,
obviously can work both ways, but with you I don't see it working that well. So I think you need to slightly, you don't want to be back here and reaching out. Well, if you had to pick up this music stand, it'd be much easier to pick it up from here.
Yeah.
So you don't really want to do that, right?
No.
So you want to switch, you want the, you want to be closer to your body, or closer, in this case it's the finger, right? So if I'm doing this, if I'm playing like this, I'm going to get lots of noise. But basically,
That's not quite what I meant. I mean, that's, we don't want this.
No.
Right? Okay. So just let the fingers come down there. Now, when you're balancing the right hand, you've got to balance especially the thumb and the A finger.
If those are set well, I and M can adapt. So I always have people balance the P and A first. And you're not going to get it doing this. You can't have the wrist back here. That the whole power of the hand is here, so you want the wrist a little further forward, at least. Right? And balance P and A. You're too far back, you would like it. Because you want to be able to follow through with the fingers. Now, don't have the fingers too straight. You've got to bend the fingers, because they're unequal length. So if you go straight up with them, your hand will be a mess. Right? They all have to be bent. Some have to, the M finger, which is the longest finger, has to be the most bent. Right? I still think you need to bring the hand forward slightly. Look, can you see that?
No, I don't want the wrists so in such a terrible bend. Something like this, yeah, something like this. And feel that the thumb being the strongest, we take weight away from the thumb, we throw weight onto the knee. Now watch where you're attacking the free stroke. The other thing you're doing
is this. You do this. Squeeze together the flesh into the nail. So here's the preparation and the first attack and the follow through. That happens very fast. But what everybody trying to forget is this. Listen to this difference in the sound. If I do this, if I kick back out, there's more life in the sound. If you want to see a mechanism that does it perfectly, you open up a piano and watch the hammer come up and hit the piano. And it does exactly this. It does this, and then the minute it's not being used, it falls into complete relaxation. So watch the finger, like a piston. You see? So preparation, attack, and follow through, and don't forget to come back. It's not this. Your trajectory, you're coming up into the hand like this. You're coming up like this. I want you to come back. So you push the string down. Watch the trajectory, because you don't want to do this, right? What's the wrist doing so high? Look. You play this etude?
I don't think
you should learn that. And you can start practicing the real level etude. You can start with the A finger here. And then on the way back down, you put the thumb down. So you always have a finger stabilizing the hand. Watch this finger. It's mostly just along for the ride and stabilizing the hand.
want to practice. One is a staccato on one note. Well, just the same. Don't cave the wrist down, neither too high nor too low. No. Always have a finger resting. So I might keep the thumb resting. Yeah, it's great. Now I can also do chain reaction. So I always prepare one finger ahead. Try not to do this. In the air like you do. Always have something that's connected. You see? Rest it on the fifth. There. Good. Yes. Try to come back a little bit further. You just come, you do this. But I want you to come back. I come back maybe two strings. Watch the trajectory of the finger. Don't have too much of a crook in the wrist here. Straighten your wrist up a little more. That's it. Watch my hand. Imitate. Okay, now we're doing the chain reaction, which works. I prepare exactly one. So I play. If I play with thumb, I prepare the index. I prepare hand. I prepare. So bop. Exactly when you would prepare, so play. It's like a 64th note after the note. You want a basis now. You tend to play out of this note, but you need to play to drive from this note. That was better. That's at least two strings back. Now with an M finger, you don't come two strings back. I want you to come two strings back. When you follow through, look. My follow through is. You do this. You do this. You do this. You see what you do? You do this. No. Look at the difference. But I don't have the A finger behind ever. I never have it behind. Yes. I don't play like this. I never have these two fingers behind the other. I always have them in order. Looks like a guitar hand. Good. Good. Now you just need to connect them so that you don't, it's like, your fingers are now like you're walking like this. You know, but you don't walk like that. Fine. So do the same thing with your finger. Don't separate. Once you play with this, this is not behind here. Line the fingers up like they're about to come down and play. Don't have them back here like this. That's right. They don't have to be actually on the string. Don't let A and M keep them out. I don't want to see this. You see what you do? You have M and A behind I. No. Oh, way, way, way over. Okay, I'm gonna stop now, because I have to get ready for Bill's thing at 6:30, and I think you probably do too.
So thank you, everybody. It's been great.